when you're a baby, right? Yeah. Do you know that that's what Jesus called God? Abba. That's not, we translate it as Father or Heavenly Father, right? But Abba is what babies in his language called their dads. So we can talk to God just like we would talk to the most loving parent, and just as we're learning about life and how we just need God to love us and provide for us, we can say, Dada, Father. And guess what? God loves us fully and completely and always. That's pretty cool, right? So when you're thinking, I'm not sure how to pray, you don't have to know how to pray. You can just talk to God like you would talk to your mom or your dad or somebody who loves you just as much, maybe like your grandparents. Sometimes their love feels like so special, right? Okay, well, let's pray. Abba, Dada, thank you for your love. Help us to also love you in return. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. And know that wherever you are in your journey of faith, this is God's house, and you're most welcome here. Let's center ourselves now in this love of God as Christy, not Carol, Christy is playing our prelude. Thank you. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let's stand now as we are able to sing our opening hymn, hymn number 526, God is Here.
Jimmy, I see that you're reading in church tomorrow. Your mom and I were so proud of you because you learned to read so early in your life, but you really never got any better. So, happy Father's Day. Don't blow it. The reading today is from 1 John. A reading from the first book of John. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers and sisters. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help? Like children, let us love not in word or speech, but in deed and truth. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God and we receive from him whatever we ask because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this, we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us.
How do they do, Dad?
The word of the Lord.
Well done, my son. How can we know for sure? I think if there is one question that has dominated philosophical and religious thought since probably the beginning of human consciousness It is probably this one. How can we know for sure? Specifically, the question is, how can we know for sure who God is and what God thinks of us? The deeper question of whether or not there is a God is a more modern question asked only in the last 500 years of human history. Prior to that, it was universally assumed that God or different gods controlled much of what happened to us. And the only questions were whether you put your faith in the right God and if you knew how to please this God or gods. Ancient people mostly determined that if the crops were good, if life was going well, then the gods must be pleased. This if-then thinking led to many unfortunate superstitious beliefs. If we offer the right sacrifices to the right gods and good things happen, then we repeat this ritual in the hope that good things continue to happen. But when bad things inevitably do happen, it means we must have not done it right, or we didn't do it enough. Some cultures even went so far as to adopt child sacrifice in order to appease their gods. Now, thankfully, this practice is ancient history, but unfortunately, the if-then thinking is still popular today. Many churches still teach that if we are pleasing God, then all will go well for us. And if things are not going well, which there's always evidence that they're not, then that is evidence of our own sin and God's displeasure. This is not what the Bible teaches, but they use the Bible to justify this basic human desire for security and prosperity. If then thinking is simply how the world thinks. It's how the world typically works. Every time we buy something or get paid, it is using if-then thinking. If I do a good job, then I hope you will continue to pay me. If I swipe my credit card, then I promise to pay the bill when it arrives. If not, then there are negative consequences. Really, I could offer a never-ending list of how much we live in this if-then world. And it's not bad to think this way. In fact, it's necessary for there to be consequences for our actions or inactions. The problem is when we apply this worldly thinking to love, especially God's love. Now, we might say to our children or grandchildren, if you behave in church, then I'll take you out for ice cream after. That's perfectly appropriate. I'm behaving, Dad. But I hope we would never say to our children, if you behave, I will love you and take care of you, but if not, then you're on your own, kid. I withdraw my love. Right? That's not appropriate. When we read John's sermon, however, it can easily sound like God is using if-then thinking. John writes in chapter 3 alone, and this is throughout the letter, no one who continues to sin has either seen Christ or known him. The one who does what is sinful is of the devil. Anyone who does not do what is right is not God's child, nor is anyone who does not love their brother or sister. Anyone who does not love remains in death. Anyone who hates a brother or a sister is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life in them. If a brother or sister comes to you in need and you are able to help but don't, then God's love is not in you. Does it sound kind of like you better be good? Or God's not going to love you anymore? You're not going to be God's child? I think it can sound that way sometimes. So I was following a van in Rochester as I was running errands just a couple days ago. And it had hand-painted messages all over the back and the sides of it, which said, "Repent of your sins and be saved. God's holy word is truth, capital T, truth. And Jesus is Lord." And I don't remember, but if this is just me projecting, but I'm pretty sure there were exclamation points on everything. I was conflicted by these messages because actually nothing it said was technically wrong. I could agree with each of those messages, but it gave a vibe to me that seemed so far from loving that I automatically wanted to reject it. It felt more angry than loving, more judgmental than merciful, and I'm betting that the man, and I'm betting it was a man, wrote these messages on his van, obviously read his Bible with if-then thinking. If you repent, you will be saved, it said. If you don't, well, he didn't spell that out for us. Actually, now that I think about it, I never actually saw the passenger side of the van. So, maybe that had that message. In any case, when we read John's sermon, we need to understand that John isn't thinking about our relationship with God as transactional. If you do this for me, then I will do that for you. If you don't, then I won't. Instead, he's thinking with a because, therefore frame of reference. John writes, "This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and therefore we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters." Again, in chapter 4, he repeats, "Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love our brothers and sisters." This does not make God's love for us conditional, and therefore one in which we can never really be sure of. Rather, it is about the fact that since we've already received this great love of God, then we can gain confidence in this love by dedicating ourselves to living in it. John writes, "Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. This is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence." This is how we know. We know the truth in the Spirit of God when we participate in it. There's no other way to know for sure if we're pleasing God than in being in a live, living relationship with God by practicing our faith and loving our neighbor. It's not about being perfect, because we know we always will need to be forgiven, but it is about participation. I'll never forget the amazing Jeffo. Has anybody ever heard of the amazing Jeffo? He died a number of years ago, but he was a young man who was blind, And he had crippling arthritis in his hands. And he did magic tricks for kids at churches all over the Twin Cities. And he had a helper that helped set up the tricks for him so he could do them. And his message was, our ability doesn't matter to God as much as our availability. We won't gain confidence in God's love for us by intellectually getting our theology right, though that is still a good thing to do. We won't gain confidence in God's love for us by how we feel and what our heart tells us is true. Our hearts may still convict us, and though we may be faithful, at times, at many times, we will feel God's absence more than God's presence. But John tells us God is greater than our hearts. So we gain confidence in God's love by living in it, by embodying the faith. John tells us to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded us. I thought that was interesting because John didn't say in a shorter way, believe in Jesus, right? He said, but believe in the name of Jesus. That draws our attention to embodying the character of Jesus as we believe in him. To pray in the name of Jesus is to adopt the spirit of Jesus, not just to use his name, right? Like, this is how we end our prayers. This is how we get what we want because we have this special magical name that we can use. No, when we pray in the name of Jesus, we humble ourselves to say, I want to be like you, Jesus. Help your love flourish through me, even in the midst of all my faults. It's the name of Jesus and the attempt to love each other that we can know for sure. Ours is a participatory faith, an embodied faith, not just an intellectual or even an emotional one. And John tells us we know love by this. He laid down his life for us. God would rather die for us than see us separated from his love. Our God is not a God who demands to be served, who demands obedience before loving us, or holds out a potential withdrawal of that love if God isn't happy with us. That's not our God. Our God is fully committed to loving us always. The prophet Isaiah puts it like this. It reports God as saying, can a mother forget the infant at her breast, walk away from the baby that she just bore? Maybe so, even so. But if mothers might forget, I, God, will never forget you. Look, I've written your names on the back of my hands. And then we are invited to return this love to God. Notice I emphasize invited, because a love that is not freely given isn't love anymore. Professor Anna Case Winter says, perfect power is not domination and control, as we often think about God being omnipotent. Perfect power is the power of love. God is love, and love never controls the beloved. Our response is absolutely ours to freely give or not. So we definitely are not needing to try to earn God's favor or keep God's favor because we already have it. But hopefully this love will inspire us to love in return. If it doesn't, then we only cheat ourselves by not participating fully and wholeheartedly in this love. And don't all of our best relationships work this way? I think this is what John offers, example after example, both negative and positive, of that love, the relationships, they aren't conditional. Like, if you do this for me, then I'll do that for you. I mean, that may be part of the relationship, but that's not the essence of it, right? Isn't the essence that because this love, this gift between us is given, therefore we're inspired to freely give it in return? And we gain assurance and confidence in this love by participating in it, by committing ourselves to it, by abiding in it. Now, I have some very old dear friends and some that will remain old and dear friends that I never talk to, right? We don't talk, we don't text, we don't whatever, but every once in a while, there'll be a small little text. That friendship, that love, is a memory. It's not an ongoing relationship. The trouble with faith is too many people treat faith as a memory and not a living relationship. Being loved unconditionally is not just the start. I mean, it is the start, it's not the end of an embodied faith, a living faith. Actually participating fully and wholeheartedly in this love assures us that this love of God is real and dependable. I think about it as a couple who's still just deeply in love with each other after decades and decades of marriage. They have confidence in that love, right? They're not questioning, do you really love me? Although Tevye comes to mind on Fiddler on the Roof. But you understand, right? Yeah. It's like, I don't need to question it anymore because I've been living in it for so long. I know that it's true. John tells us, this is how we know we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in God's presence. Let's sing together our hymn of the day, hymn number 722, O Christ, Your Heart Compassionate. We stay seated for reflection.
Let us now pray together. Most holy and merciful God, we come before you today as a congregation of people who want to take time to say thank you. Thank you for being our Father. Thank you that your mercies abound even when we are not at our best. Over and over in your word, you have commanded us to love one another. But we confess, Lord, that even though it can be our intention, we know that fear, shame, and pride often get in our way. And we start to think of only ourselves and our way. Lord, help us to trust in you for our needs so that we can truly love others in ways that help us all. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we ask for your blessing on all fathers everywhere. Help them to turn to you as their role model, slow to anger and abounding with love and care for their children. Help them to realize how important they are in a child's life, especially in the ways that they can show true, unconditional love like you do. Give them patience and wisdom to encourage, guide, and protect, whether their children are tiny or grown. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And dear Lord, we ask that you be with those who no longer have their Father with them, or who never have known their Father. We ask that you minister to them in very special ways, filling the hole that is left. May they know you intimately, so that they can experience your heart of love as a Father, and your presence ever encouraging and guiding them. And may you also bring others into their lives who can fill in many tangible ways with love and support. Lord, in your mercy. Jesus, our Savior and healer, we bring to you in prayer our dear loved ones that are in great need of your healing touch. We know and trust that you care even more deeply than we do for them. Please bring healing and comfort to our friends here at Faith. We lift up Carol, Jenny, Alta, Donald, Les, and Claudia. We also bring to you in prayer other friends and family for whom we know are needing your arms of comfort and encouragement. Please be with Pat, Barb, Chuck, Lyle, Kate, Daryl, Judy, Carolyn, Wayne, Patty, Betty, Bill, Jan, Gary, Jack, Johan, Jim, John, Sophie, and Cheryl. Give strength to their bodies and peace for their souls. Lord, in your mercy, great comforter, be with all who are grieving the loss of loved ones, especially be with the friends and family of Vern Barr. May they be able to share the sweet memories and know that he is now in your eternal loving arms. Lord, in your mercy, Holy Spirit, as we begin a new week, help us to never forget that your mercies are new every morning. And no matter how busy our days and lives may be, may we find the time, even for a few moments, to breathe in your spirit of love. Help us to believe that no matter what may happen during our days, that you will always be by our side, protecting, guiding, and leading us ever deeper into trusting you. May you show us how to handle both the tough stuff and to enjoy the many blessings we still have in you. In the name of Jesus, your Son, who has saved this world, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Now let's stand together as we are able, as a sign that we offer our whole selves for service in God's kingdom, along with our offering.
Thankful hearts and voices raise to everyone.
pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love, through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And our Lord has invited us to pray along with him. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Then come, receive the love that has been prepared for you. strengthen you and keep you in everlasting life. Amen. Now please stand as you're able as we follow the light of Christ out into the world, singing hymn number 660, Lift High the Cross.
Thanks be to God.